being sober at the time. I was just smoking dope. I wasn't doing coke. I had put together 6 years of doing coke that it was bad luck and all this shit. And after about a year of being clean, I had a nice girlfriend. I started dabbling again. Coke was $18,000 an ounce in Colorado. I was getting it for $800 in New Jersey. So I would fly back to Jersey, fly back. So I got into that shit.
Wow.
And then I built up this cash and I fucking snorted it all and I had to leave Aspen home with like $40,000. I moved to Boulder. I get to Boulder, I'm detailing cars, and I'm pretty good. And I start selling cars, and I always went and took night classes. Believe it or not, in all my primes, I always went to Colorado.
Well, you were up.
Yeah.
You were up.
I love going to school. I love learning. So I went to Boulder, and I got myself into a way of life that was phenomenal. It's like so weird. Like when people say old habits die hard, I was making like $4,000 to $5,000 a month. I was going to some classes. I was doing a little coke. I was working out. And all of a sudden, one day, I just got into this coke thing again. And I started working with this guy in Boulder. His name was Ken Vella. And he said he was going to rob his roommate. His roommate had a couple kilos of coke. Well, I decided I was going to rob Ken Felton. So I had this bike going to help me, and it was really weird. Our plan was to, the bike was going to be the front man. He was going to buy the drugs, and he was going to rip out the gun. To rob us both. That was the plan. So it was like, it was that expression, what tackle for every week. And it was really weird. The day came, November 18th, and I picked Fell up, took him to Tidwell's house. Tidwell was selling a machine gun. Tries to rob the guy, but when I picked up Fella, I had noticed that he had hit the kilo and covered the ceiling. It was standing ceilings, and then he had like an ounce in the jar. So we show up, and this guy, Tidwell, pulls the gun out of me and Fella. We tie Fella up, put Fella in the room, you know, and then he goes over to Fella's to rob him. He comes back and says he can't find nothing. He comes back and says, I'm people.
That's, if you have questions, ask.
Cash and drugs, and I took coke on the drugs. So I said, you're trying to rob me? I didn't let him know. I said, something wasn't right here, so I got in my car. And it was the weirdest thing. I walked in this house, and I turned in and walked into a building with a guard. Just told the guard the story, walked to the second floor, kicked the door down, went in, pulled the ceiling down. I was already involved in this
crime.
I took the kilo, and I put a newspaper thing, one of those vending things, on the bottom, where you go put a quarter on a newspaper. I always put their drugs under the vending and make drops.
The events of the last dance by Huffman and Fanny.
So expressed
a slow to come to a man whose name was so short. The absolute is not a clue, but it is a brand controlled by the chosen of the Dark Three, aiming to use it to take control of the side coast, while we carry the purple governed by the throne and by extension the chosen.
He
takes but one order to transform him into an army of man flesh. This would have been your fate too, but not the extra prison. The mysterious visitor inside it. With her help, you have uncovered the cult for what it really is. A clan of conquest, orchestrated by the gods of death themselves. Together, you have the power to thwart the Death Cult.
Tattoo,
followed this path to its end without the going on that own set to the chosen. It will be a set to you. And we liberate them from that concept and our religious delusions. And we use the bear we gain to our own purposes.
She was in trouble with her husband. She didn't want to play college. So he put her in one of his bedrooms. And in fact, they were living together. And she would tell him they wouldn't fuck because she was Catholic. So he bought it. So she needed $10,000 to get a divorce. And that was his main motivation for this.
Oh, if you're Catholic, you can't fuck, but you can do dance?
Are you fucking crazy? Are you fucking kidding me?
I don't know about that.
This kid bought into it. This kid was in love with her. And she was like, fuck you, I'm gonna get the $10,000 to get the divorce. So his motivation was to get the $10,000. Me, my motivation was to party. I was sick and tired of living in Boulder. I was ready to go back to my buddies who were in the clubs. They were snorting every night. Fucking and sucking, and here I am in Colorado looking like a snowman selling cars.
Thank you.
how God works. I had two felonies. I had one more felony, and it's a career criminal in car robbery. And I was driving there, and the neighbor I went to pick up, she was four, and he said, my Uber asked what the word spit meant. I said, where'd you hear that? She goes, every time you call the house, that's what John said. You go get in the car. And I drove right there. So I was to drop him off at Safeway. I don't know if you know Boulder, or it's on 30 on the outskirts. And I got out of the car, and I gave him out to him. I said, I don't really like that. I've spit in his face once before when I dropped the kid off, because he told me not to take the kid to Jurassic Park. The boyfriend will never fucking tell me.
Right.
You know, relax. Yeah. So there's one man, profound, like a man, that can look at my daughter, and by the way, it's a situation. My daughter just said spit. She was an East Coast little girl. We're in. She heard it in school.
Right.
But they don't use that word in Colorado. Only racist fucks like you, cocksucker from Idaho, use that word. And he goes, I don't know what you're talking about. Felicia, I looked in my face and I'm going to give you an out. I'm going to give you 2 minutes to say that you did it. You're right. This is all shake hands and part front. But now you call my little girl a liar. And he's like, I didn't do it. I didn't do it. I said, you got one opportunity to come clean. He didn't say, Felicia, with everything I had, I gave him in 25 years. I punched him in the fucking eye. In a safe way, right outside. And some lady's like, I'm calling the police. I go, go mind your fucking business. Go suck a dick and all this shit. I smacked him again. He goes, I'm calling the police. And I go, you know what? I'm going to give you one to go. And I hit him in the same eye. Bam. My little girl's in the car. And she's fucking going on. That's what I really wanted to do. Cops came. I did an AIDS benefit. Under an alias. I got COVID.
My mom was getting out there in Miami when I did. not in my country. That was when I was boiling blood. And she would talk about a baseball game. No. Play the piano. She makes me two times two all morning for an hour. It was a great, she really worked on that kid. But at night, I lived with him. And he would show me guns. And he would go pick up money. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
He would introduce me to his girlfriends. So he had really two lives. And then the thing why he was so tight with me was because in 1966, you know, my dad used to get high. Right, they used to do heroin together. So one night, and they used to sell heroin together in the 60s when there were two young kids from Cuba. And one night, my dad had a party for his birthday, and it was, he was at home. He had something that Monday morning, and they called him at midnight.
Despite
this is
your
Manolo, best
attempts
my dad,
to be separate,
a heart attack.
There is awareness.
And he really was.
Everywhere.
And he kept saying, you guys are fucking with me, baby. I'm three.
Presence.
I'm not leaving.
Like
and
I'm
following
him.
The next day, he found out my dad died. So he always felt really guilty about it. So he always really nice to me. He always went the extra mile. He's the one that told me the story. My mom always told me that a heart attack, he really died.
If you insist,
So he was real tight with my dad. So ever since my dad died, he felt he owed me. So he was just really good. And I fucked him. I fronted a kilo on the plane.
Of course you did.
And then the Hurricane Andrew came. I talked to him when he was down. I didn't really front a kilo. He was mad at me because he found out I was selling coke. And he goes, you know, you can't sell coke if you come down and visit me. He goes, that's the last thing your fans want. He goes, I don't mind it.
Had he gotten pretty straight?
No, he had just gotten out of prison. I would go down there every summer.
Join me.
76, they came to my home and they accused him of murder from the early 60s or something.
Together.
He used to come to California and pick up weed in a trailer and bury it under the trailer and bring his kid to them. And he just had his kid. He was white when they were cooking hot dogs, the all-American Cuban family. You know, and he would have weed buried under the truck and he'd go to Miami, New York. When he was a kid, they'd visit us in New York every summer. That's what they were doing.
Right.
They were bringing weed. Like in December, they would come to New York. July, we would go down there.
Wow.
So it was that kind of family.
I think everyone should rethink when their family comes to visit what the real reason
for the
visit
is. You know, I could tell him and my mom and my dad would stay up for a day, so I knew they were partying.
Right.
You know, Vivian always had the kids. But in 76, they accused him of murder or whatever. We had a long trial, and it was weird because that's why I never understood drug dealing and that stuff. Because at his peak of his life, at 50 fucking six, he'll knock on your door for something you did when you were 35. And he had to give up everything and go to a federal prison in Atlanta, and he was there. And while he did that, his family had to move into a two-bedroom fucking apartment.
Right.
And live off nothing. And then he got out of jail and he did some more shit. He was right back in business. And I went down to the visit in 84. But 84 was the height of cocaine. So I would lie. I would tell him I was coming down to visit him. But what I was really doing was bring the coke back to New York.
It's full circle at that point.
And he found out. And he was really hurt. He was like, I can't believe you would do that. He was like, besides, I have it here. You know,
right.
He was really pissed. He's like, you're doing that. Besides, I have to come here in my house. You're not even helping me. Like, if you were saying to me, listen, I got a connection to the East Coast. He goes, you cut me out. Like, he was really hurt. It's
yeah.
Really a weird story. And I called him after Hurricane Andrew in 91 and told him that I named my daughter after his daughter. He was blind. And then the next thing I know, he died. So I never really had my, his wife was really upset with me. I think Vivian, because his wife really lied to me in a terrible. She was pushing me to be like a smart guy.
Right, you are a smart guy, Joe.
Yeah, I know, but fuck. Yeah, the daughter was brilliant. She played the piano. The kid had some problems, but I guess he's better than that now. I've befriended him on Facebook. But I think that life was too hard. Like, that my mother was Jacqueline's godmother. And when you're Cuban, you're Catholic, that's really big. That means
right.
Should happen to that person. You take over, no questions asked. You have to pick that kid up. Like, she would come to spend summers. She was pretty hot, too. But I could see in her note that she wrote back to me that we were done. Like, getting literally even. That was a hard part for them.
Oh, sure.
You know,
sure.
They came from this decent family. Meanwhile, their father was fucking shooting people and selling drugs. And she's really interested in my son. But it's so weird how I see my life now sometimes. And I actually shake when I think of those times. I think, oh my God. You know, one time we robbed this house and the lady had a Siamese cat. This is my first experience with cats.
Oh, really?
And this is, we used to go to the drug dealer's house, this Colombian lady.
Right.
This is 82, guys. Scarface hadn't even fucking come out.
Yeah.
You can see there's a lot of Colombians in this chip. captain's woods on an 8-ball, so me and my two buddies went down there, and we made my one buddy go up there. He's like, I don't like to climb, put a gun on his back, we fucking climb up there. So he goes in. The reason why she went over the door is because she had one of those skinny stockings, skinny-looking, Egyptian-looking ones.
Right.
That was fun.
Yeah.
So we're like, Mike, what's going on up there? I was like, get my cow. He said, I got a cat on top of me. I'll never forget, he comes to the mouth, he looks over, and the cat's on his head, and his two claws pulling his eye out like this, and he's like, I'm coming down. And he's trying to pull the cat off his head, like he's got the cat on his neck. And we're like, don't fucking come down. Don't come down without the cup. He had to go back in with the cat on his head. He punched the cat or whatever. He threw like a bag of coke at a bunch of children. And he tried to hook his leg over again. And just come out. You see the cat flying above me. And grabbed him again. And went down. He came down. And we robbed the fucking house forever. But the story was, till this day, my buddy, who's like my brother, he still had cat claws in his fucking head because he didn't want to go to the hospital. Because he thought they wouldn't have like fingerprints of the cat. So till this day, like, if you feel over here, there's like a little lump. By now, the nail part is disintegrated, but just the skin puncture must have swelled. He always, like, whenever we're like, let me touch it, he's like, fuck you, I'm sucking. You don't want that cat fucking attack. You didn't tell me he was up there with a cat.
What was it?
Shit. That's awesome. Wow. Aren't you lucky to be listening to Joey Diaz and his wonderful stories?
And then, after we robbed that house, like, she was connected big time, so one night, I'm leaving for Colorado. I had my mind made up. I was going to Colorado Springs. It was the number one growing city until June 30th of 1985. I had already lived in Aspen. I'm going back to Colorado. It was a mess by then, Colorado Springs. It was a mess. It was a fucking mess. And I get to this bar, it's my last time at the spot. And he said, I'm having a great time. I'm doing powder, this Asian credit card, I'm using it, I'm buying gold and shit. I was out of my body and mind. He is early, he comes over to that. And so I told him the other side of the room, he goes, listen, man, that lady sent out like 10 guys looking for you. They know you're in town. They've been looking for you for 2 fucking weeks. They just haven't found you. They're gonna shoot you. That's what I got the night before I left town. And I'm like, what? She's gonna shoot you, whatever the fuck. That was like 300 friends. I go, you know what? They come into Union City. Let's get the fuck out. I want my friends to get shot because of me, you know?
Right.
But 3 years later, this lady, I didn't even know she knew it was us. But she had figured out some way or the other, so. Like,
wow.
So,
wow. Yeah, you always gotta be. It's like an awesome Powers movies when they always have a cat for, you know,
James
Bond movies.
Yeah, but we didn't know she had the fucking cat. That was the secret. She was like the Iron Man for the dragon. That was the secret. He didn't have a hand. He was saying the same thing. She didn't let us know fucking what the cop, the cat was no one. Those were those stories. My mother died. She had, my mom was a collector of really gaudy gold jewelry. And she was become a drug dealer, so my mom had all the gaudy shit. She was a cat. And when she lost the bar, her daily income, and the numbers, the Pix 3 systems came, and my mother's primary business was numbers, which is a way of gambling in New York. It's the last 3 numbers of what the track makes. So you can't fix it, you know. Whatever the track makes that day, they take the last 3 numbers. And then the late 70s, picket came, so the numbers business sure went down too. So my mom was hurting, you know, my mom died. They added her pawn tickets. She had $220,000 in jewelry to pawn show.
Wow.
And my father took it out. He was pissed. I remember after my mom died, like 2 weeks later, we were driving all around New York to the different pawn shops. She had stacks of those tickets.
The Rock resists.
He took all that jewelry
and
I guess he melted it down or whatever the fuck he did with diamonds. My father's real jewelry, $225,000.
The Rock resists all attempts to shatter it.
She probably lost it all on the fucking Mets.
Right.
Tom Seaver and the fucking Mets. That's a true story. My mom was a degenerate fucking gambler. Three tracks a day. My mom could hit the number for $20,000 and the next day be broken.
Well, how do you feel about it now, though? Do you have like a negative feeling towards that your mom was someone that did that? Or is it?
Do you
look at it with any kind of warmth? You know what I mean? Like,
no, well, that could have been my money. You know, I don't think of it that way. I think of it as my mom. best steakhouse get steaks. My mom lived like a fucking Puerto Rican. Steaks. Even if she didn't know, you give a steak.
Right.
Give him a fucking beer. Give him a steak. Do give him a beer. That's what that's how my mother dropped money. Whatever you know, sometimes you get lucky and bring your most mommy. If I get an egg, can I get that special thing? Or my mom would have to hear that, and once she hit the number, she'd call me and go, hey, I'm coming home. I'll give you that money you wanted for the fucking thing. Don't bother me for another month.
Right.
And I would say, but you said it was for my report card. Forget it. Just get it now. Make sure you bring me home eggs.
Right.
My mother would spend her money one day, and she lived by the fucking nickel. One day she had it, one day she didn't. If we didn't have it, we gotta make a stop.
Right.
You know, we gotta make a stop at the pawn shop and pick up some cash. It was just a way of life for her. It was just a way. It was just a cost of doing business. But right after the longest yard, I went to Beaumont, Texas, which is next to Houston. Houston, one of my favorite spots. And I went to Beaumont. This was about 5 years ago. This was weird. I went down there, and I was deep in the cold thing. I was deep in it. I went on the road just to get high in a hotel room. Whether there was somebody there or not, I couldn't even care. I was with Terry. You know, Terry lived here, and I was with her here for a week. I couldn't do anything, so when I went on the road, I was just losing my fucking mind. So I go to Beaumont, and I'm headed to Houston the following week. And I go to Beaumont, the home of
Janis Joplin.
They have the Beaumont, they have the Janis Joplin Museum. It's like a pair of underwear and a syringe. It's the most famous museum you'll see in your life. It is. If I went there with Tom Rhodes.
Oh, you did.
When you go to Beaumont, you go to this
place.
And they have great food. Well, anyway, this club in Beaumont. So, Guy Slade, a good friend of mine, his brother was a white rapper in Beaumont, Texas, which is right next to like the home of the Ku Klux Klan. Like, there's a town behind Beaumont. They hate everybody. They even hate white people.
Right.
And it's there. They hate each other. And they sit at the table. Fuck you. And it's just crazy. So I go to Beaumont, and I'm looking for powder. And the kid says, I got no powder. And I go, I don't need value. But you know what I know people will do? You know, just give me 30 of them. So I figure out, bring him back to LA.
Right.
So the first night he popped one, we go back there, we were sleeping like a baby. It was Thursday night at 30. Friday morning, I popped in the club at 8. I'm like, this is great. And I smoked a joint and I was high all day. So that night I go to the club and I pop one, I get some powder. I start pumping powder. The second show, I get like two more, three more. After the show, I